Number 9. Shipbreaking yards. Disposing of a large cargo vessel is a pretty complicated process, especially doing it properly and in a way that causes minimal waste and environmental damage. Most of the time, container ships are dismantled at shipbreaking yards in India and Bangladesh. The metal is scrapped and every usable and recyclable part of a ship, including doors and toilet seats, gets repurposed or reused. Sadly, there's a reason that most shipbreaking yards are in certain parts of the world. The work is dangerous and toxic, so the industry tends to set up shop in places with cheap labor and less restrictive environmental regulations. In a quest to offer an insider's perspective of what really goes on at these facilities, author William Langyavisha visited the Elang Shipyard in Gujarat, India. He detailed his observations in his book, The Outlaw Sea, describing the site as a shoreline strewn with industrial debris on the oily Gulf of Cambrai in the Arabian Sea. Measuring roughly 6 miles long, the narrow, smoky industrial zone was lined with as many as 200 ships at one point. Each vessel was in a different stage of being dismantled and was spilling debris onto the tidal flats. Langyavisha described seeing emaciated workers among heavy soot and smoke, going dangerously close to a burning, unbearably loud and hot furnace. Multiple photographers, including Edward Bertinsky, have captured photos of the daily goings-on at sites like Elang. These sobering images show workers standing around campfires and toxic debris and the disassembled components of a ship they had taken apart. Even more troubling, the pictures reveal a stream of hazardous materials leaking into the sand and out to the sea. In the words of blogger Jeff Manna of Building Blog, the dismantled ships represent the scraps of a first world that sent its waste elsewhere. And he's not wrong. It's an undeniable characteristic among privileged countries to treat garbage as an out-of-sight, out-of-mind matter without lending additional thought to how it's handled or where it ends up. But sites like Elang are proof that, at the end of the day, someone pays the price for our first world wastefulness. Number 8. Thessaloniki Train Cemetery. Outside Greece's second largest city, Thessaloniki, there's an ever-expanding collection of decommissioned trains left behind by the country's national railway. It's known as the Hellenic Railways Organization. The decaying cars began accumulating in the 1980s. Today, there are over 1,000 of them at the property. They attract lots of urban explorers, but serve no other purpose. The company tried to sell the cars as scrap several times, but these attempts were unsuccessful. Very few honest business owners seem interested in associating with a site which has a reputation for scrap smuggling and other shady dealings. Not all the trains are worth scrapping anyway, according to some rail enthusiasts who believe many of them should be preserved for their historic value. The yard contains some remarkable vintage cars, including antique wagons dating back to 1895, which once traveled back and forth between Thessaloniki and Istanbul. There are also vehicles that the Nazis seized as World War II trophies, according to photographer Nikki Panu, who spotted the ill-gotten cars during a visit to the site. On her website, Panu echoed the sentiments of many who think it's a shame that the vintage cars have been left to rot, unguarded, and at the mercy of vandals who have dismantled them and sold what they can for scrap. Describing the wagons as lost pieces of heritage, she further pointed out that it's unfortunately too late to save many of them. Number 7. Zugel Tank Cemetery. In a small field just a few miles outside the German town of Zugel, there is a collection of around 24 Leopard 1 and M47 Patton tanks arranged in neat lines. Nobody seems to know why they're there, and although it's impossible not to notice the site, the German military is strangely secretive about it. Designed by Porsche, the Leopard 1 tank functioned as West Germany's main battle tank during the Cold War, when the country was split both physically and ideologically by the Berlin Wall. Nearly 6,500 of the vehicles were produced after it entered service in 1965. The Leopard 1 was a popular choice among European militaries for some time, before the last of them were withdrawn from service in 2003 and replaced by the Leopard 2. Named after American World War II General George S. Patton, the M47 battle tank entered service in 1951. It was primarily used by the US Army and Marine Corps, and you may be surprised to learn that it's the only American tank that the US military has never used in combat. But the M47 has seen war under other countries' militaries, and some are still in operation today. While there's no physical barrier stopping curious explorers from investigating the tank graveyard, there is a strictly worded sign cautioning against trespassing and threatening legal action against violators. Some suspect that the property is an active military site and that helicopter pilots use the tanks for target practice, so it's probably best to obey the no trespassing sign. After all, better safe than sorry. Number 6. Częstochowa Train Graveyard. Częstochowa is Poland's 13th most populated city. During the communist era, it was among the country's leading industrial and educational centers. Today, the city is popular among tourists and is still an industrial hub, thanks to the establishment of the Katowice Special Economic Zone, which offers incentives to business owners who set up shop there. But times nevertheless change, which is why Częstochowa is home to an abandoned train depot that has seen much busier days. During its heyday, the station served as a vital connection between the historic Warsaw-Vienna Railway and the rest of Europe. Over the years, 6 more rail stations opened throughout the city, and the depot closed because it was no longer needed. The disused property now functions as a storage facility for an eerie collection of aging rail cars that have been taken out of service. Częstochowa's landscape has changed considerably, but the city of 240,000 is still lively and has a lot going for it. It is here that crumbling remnants of the past coexist alongside the fast-paced day-to-day happenings of modern life. This could perhaps explain why urban explorers are tangled in a contentious debate over whether the station is a true train graveyard or a neglected part of a larger depot. Technicalities aside, the property is fascinating regardless, drawing many off-the-beaten-path explorers who are hoping to catch a first-hand glimpse of a bygone era. Would you like to check this place out? Let us know in the comments below, and don't forget to subscribe if you haven't already. Number 5. Excavator Graveyard. When World War II ended, Germany was parceled out between Great Britain, France, the US, and the Soviet Union. A line was drawn, splitting the country into the capitalist West and the communist East. Formerly known as the German Democratic Republic, East Germany fell under strict Soviet control. Separated from West Germany by the notorious Berlin Wall, the society was closed off from the free world. It wasn't until Germany reunified in 1990 that people from countries outside the Eastern Bloc were able to gain a first-hand glimpse into what went on during those dark, divided years. And while a lot of it was utterly depressing, some sites proved fascinating. Take, for example, a former East German coal mine located in the country's northeastern region. Known today as Ferropolis, it consists of 5 massive bucket excavators that were left behind when the site closed in 1991. The equipment was abandoned simply because it was easier and less expensive than moving or dismantling it. And while it might normally be a problem to leave such gargantuan garbage lying around with no future plans for it, the machinery attracted visitors. Today, the property functions as an open-air industrial museum. It's thought to be the world's biggest collection of deserted diggers, with each excavator weighing up to 2,000 tons. The site's oldest digger, nicknamed the Mosquito, was built in 1941. Running this 223-by-92-foot monster required between 3 and 5 operators. It took the same amount of people to run a 263-foot-wide excavator known as Mad Max, which dates back to 1952. Both the Mosquito and Mad Max are small compared to the 328-foot-long Medusa, which required 5 to 7 operators. But even the Medusa is dwarfed by the site's largest machine, the 410-foot-long Gemini. Built in 1958, the contraption was controlled by a 6-to-8-person crew. The 102-by-246-foot Big Wheel is the newest digger. It was built in 1984 and requires 3-to-5 operators. Nobody has used the machine since mining closed, but they are legally protected, and in 1995, the site officially reopened as Ferropolis, giving the public a chance to see the gigantic diggers up close. Number 4. Great Train Graveyard. Near the mesmerizing salt flats of Uyuni, Bolivia, there's a collection of dozens of rusting locomotives and train cars. Known as the Great Train Graveyard, or Cementerio de Trenes, the site is located on the outskirts of a deserted former transportation hub less than 2 miles from the modern local train station. During the early 19th century, plans were made to expand the region's train network. Sadly, the project was never completed. The local mining industry began to dry up, and developers encountered issues with other countries along the planned route. Meanwhile, they kept running into technical issues. Between bad timing, disagreements, and other problems, the project ground to a screeching halt, leaving more than 100 rail cars parked in the middle of the desert. Most of the vehicles were imported from Britain during the early 1900s. Thanks to vandalism and the region's salty winds, they're heavily rusted and rapidly deteriorating. The eerie train graveyard is open to the public and draws a heavy influx of visitors who stop by on their way to the salt flats. It's situated among a vast landscape completely devoid of homes, cars, and people for as far as the eye can see, serving as a constant reminder of how far from civilization it is. Number 3. Wodzwijenka Aircraft Graveyard. Located near the Sea of Japan in Russia's Far East, the former Soviet airbase at Wodzwijenka dates at least as far back as the Cold War era. Relatively little is known about the site, which is home to 18 or more gutted Tupolev Tu-22M supersonic bombers. In fact, it's the only former Soviet base east of the Ural Mountains that ever housed the Tu-22M. Nicknamed the Blinder, the aircraft entered service in 1962. It was the first ever supersonic bomber that was made in the USSR, but the plane underperformed compared to its manufacturer's expectations when it came to range and speed. The Tu-22M was produced in small batches, and it was difficult to fly and maintain. It was prone to crashing, pitching up, and striking its tail during landings. But it was still used in combat, and is actually one of the few Soviet bombers to ever see war. The Tu-22M served in the Iran-Iraq War and in skirmishes against Tanzania and Chad. Several countries invested in the aircraft for their own militaries, including Libya and Iraq, and many are still in service today. The bomber's golden era was nevertheless short-lived, and the Tu-22M has fallen largely out of favor, leaving behind the seemingly post-apocalyptic rotting collection at Wodzwijenka. Number 2. Abandoned World War II Machines. Located in the Western Pacific, roughly 5,900 miles from the American mainland, Saipan is a commonwealth of the United States and the largest of the Mariana Islands. It's also the site of a brutal weeks-long battle between US and Japanese forces that lasted from June 15 to July 9, 1944. Known as the Battle of Saipan, the skirmish ended with an American victory and the island's capture from the Japanese. There are numerous American and Japanese historical sites on Saipan. Several Sherman M4 tanks can be found off the shore of Chalankanoa Beach, sitting in about 10 feet of water. They're remarkably intact for their age and are a popular diving attraction among tourists. The island and its surrounding waters are also home to 2 sunken Japanese planes, 2 American planes, a handful of merchant ships, some landing vehicles, and other machinery. Divers could explore the submerged vehicles, including the Japanese naval ship Shouan Maru, which sits roughly 30 feet beneath the waves. Most of these attractions are available to entry-level divers. For more experienced visitors, there's an underwater pile of World War II-era junk filled with jeeps, airplane parts, and other items that the US Navy discarded during its time in Saipan. Number 1. Châtillon Car Graveyard. According to local legend, a forest near the Belgian village of Châtillon was once home to a massive collection of rusting cars. There are conflicting stories about where the vehicles came from. One tale claims that they belonged to American soldiers who were stationed in the region during World War II. When they returned home after the war, it would have been extremely costly for them to have the cars they bought overseas shipped to the US. So the troops drove their automobiles up a hill and into a forest, parked them neatly in rows, and simply left them behind. If this is true, then it means that none of the soldiers had second thoughts and missed their vehicle enough to retrieve it. It seems unlikely, and many locals are quick to point out that a lot of the cars were post-World War II models, indicating that the site was probably an ordinary junkyard. But it's hard to know for sure, since most of the vehicles have been removed. At one point in time, there were 4 car graveyards in the area, but this is no longer the case. Anything that was worth taking is gone, and the remaining cars are decaying and heavily rusted, leaving us with little to learn from about the property's past. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, be sure to give it a thumbs up, and don't forget to subscribe. See you next time. Bye!